So I just placed my talk, title of my presentation as Plankton as Indicators of Climate Change. I am sure that many of the earlier presenters have explained what climate change is. This is too much introductory, but just for a beginning, I will mention that this is, in a scientific standpoint, we can explain climate change as change in the variability or average state of the atmosphere over durations ranging from decades to millions of years. So the point here to remember is that this is a long duration issue. So naturally the process is very slow. It's a very slow process. And if you look at the warming rate, you can see globally, you can say it's less than 0.2 degrees centigrade per decade, 10 years. So it is a so slow process. So even recording this change itself is a challenge. Then you can imagine how its implications on the biological aspects would be much more complex. Now directly to the topic of my interest, which is plankton, on which over the last 25 years I have been working. So there are two kinds of plankton, just an introductory for students. All of you know this definitely, but just to mention this, there are two major kinds of plankton. One is the plant component, microscopic plant components in the ocean, phytoplankton. And the other one, the animal component of the plankton. Basically, they are microscopic. They are floating organisms in the ocean. So now we can look at what is climate change means to ocean. I would, as a marine scientist, I would say climate change means ocean change, because just for the simple reason that 71% of the Earth's surface is covered with water, ocean. So here in this presentation, I explain ocean warming, how it implicates on plankton. Also, ocean acidification, also I will partly mention this. Both are not the same issue, but they have close connection. So I would explain both of these two environmental issues together with respect to the plankton change. The question now is that simple question, but very, very significant, important question. Where is global warming going? So mostly climate change in initial times mostly deals about changes on the land or atmosphere. But most of the warming is going into the oceans. You can see this picture, almost 94% of the warming issues, warming percentage is being connected to the ocean, and only the rest is actually applicable to atmosphere, continents, glaciers, and other things. So you can understand the impact of climate change, global warming on the marine system. So if you look at the direct impact of ocean warming, so if consider ocean temperature rises, the immediate effect is that the thermal stratification of the surface layers increases. So it prevents the mixing of the deeper nutrient-rich waters with the surface water, because as all of you know, I am sure this most of the nutrients are sitting a little deeper in the ocean. And if the surface stratification increases, it is very difficult to bring those nutrients to the surface euphotic column, upper euphotic column, for assimilation by phytoplankton. And the second point is that thermal stratification accelerates the reduction of phytoplankton productivity, and this can even cause implications on the cloud formation by feedback mechanisms, where there will be a decrease in dimethyl sulfate reduction, which is very, very critical in cloud formation. So even in that context, increase in warming or stratification of the ocean surface can make an impact. Now, so you can see how winds are being formed. Winds are nothing but the movement of air from its high pressure to low pressure. And if wind pattern and the intensity of wind changes, it impacts the ocean surface layer mixing, because that is very important to bring the subsurface nutrients to the surface to make it available for phytoplankton. Definitely it will implicate, it will cause effect on the ocean productivity patterns, the generation of algal blooms and shift in plankton diversity, and this will have an implications to the fisheries, because as all of you know, this fisheries mostly depend on the plankton components for their feeding activities. All these changes disturbs, ultimately disturbs ocean biogeochemical cycles. So this is just a picture to show that these are the two major algal blooms that is common in Indian waters, red and the green Nothiluca and Trichodosmium. But if you see the literature, you would understand that it has a seasonal pattern, even as seasonal as well as a spatial pattern in Indian seas. If the way the climate change warming increases, even this pattern and spatial extent of these blooms can change. Now the other aspect is linked to this is ocean acidification. You know that it's connected to the increase in carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. So naturally warming also increases, it favors warming, and more atmospheric carbon dioxide means more carbon dioxide in the water. It increases the acidicity, or it decreases the pH of the ocean. So even this also is a very slow process. If you see, the change is 0.1 unit of pH in 2 decades. So you can understand, on an annual scale, if you want to measure this kind of pH, it is almost impossible if you consider an oceanic environment. Please don't get mistaken with coastal waters. There are a lot of changes, but ideally for climate change, it is good to have pH measurements in an oceanic environment, where you can expect 0.1 unit of pH in 2 decades. That much slow as this process is. So, and now the main content of this presentation, plankton are good indicators. As a plankton ecologist, I try to explain you the point. Plankton are very good indicators of climate change. Why? So 4 major points I want to state here. The first one is, unlike other marine species such as fish and many intertidal organisms, few species of plankton are commercially exploited. Therefore, any long-term changes can be directly attributed to climate change. The second point is that most species are plankton species are short-lived, and so population size is less influenced by the resistance of individuals from previous years. This leads to tight coupling between environmental change and plankton dynamics. The third point is, plankton can show dramatic changes in the distribution because they are free floating and can respond easily to changes in temperature and oceanic current systems by expanding and contracting their ranges. The fourth point is, there are several recent evidences which suggest that plankton are more sensitive indicators of change than are even environmental variables themselves, because the non-linear response of biological communities can amplify subtle environmental perturbations. So this is a very important slide I borrowed from Professor Peter Barkill, who was the director of Sir Alistair Harder Foundation for Ocean Sciences in the UK. So I was a postdoc under him for quite some time. So this was a slide I borrowed from him. You can see this is a comprehensive slide. You can see you can see in the left-hand side, the top, you can see the rise in carbon dioxide, and the almost similar is the rise in the temperature. So you can consider the case of change in the global climate. So it will have implications on the phytoplankton pattern, production, diversity, and it implicates on zooplankton. And since acidicity of the ocean increases, there is a common thing called the acid test, which many of these zooplankton components, especially those having calcareous skeleton, will get affected. So the dissolution of external shells is an issue, so that those communities get affected. And all these effects will have implications on fisheries, because the fishes have to depend on plankton, its production and its hatching. So what environmental marine ecologist, plankton ecologist consider is that plankton is the ocean's pulse, in the sense that when you go to a very good doctor, first he will try to check your pulse, because that pulse will give you clear indications of your health status. The same way is this plankton. If you have a very good understanding, long-term understanding of plankton components, you will get a clear indications of which direction that ecosystem is drifting or moving. So how to tackle this issue, how to understand this climate change in terms of plankton? One possible possibility is operation of continuous plankton recorder, CPR survey. And if you see in the developed countries between US and UK, we can see that it started in 1931. We can see the CPR, it's a small towing equipment which you can attach to the ship, and you can tow when ships are on sail. So this is the longest running marine plankton survey in the world, and you can see approximately 500 taxa have been identified, and keeping a track of almost 500 zooplankton taxa for very long time. You can see 1931 onwards such data sets are being generated and maintained. And one more, a little more explanation what it is, the CPR. And you can see left hand side the first prototype of CPR, and on the right hand side image you can see the length which are being towed between US and Europe, US and UK mostly, for CPRs. You can see all those red lines are the routes which are being towed for continuous plankton recorder surveys. This resulted in the collection of almost 2 lakhs of zooplankton samples with its spatial records. It has an abundance of 450 phytoplankton and zooplankton taxa have been counted in each of this of sample. You could see this is an amazing picture on right hand side, the intensity of plankton monitoring surveys over 65 years conducted between UK and US. And now can have a look at what is the status of CPR survey on a global scale. You can see the oldest surveys between US and UK in the Atlantic. And you can see that there are so many other surveys which are of which are established relatively recently, but such surveys are there everywhere in the ocean except the Indian Ocean. Just you can see that there is no CPR survey existing even now in the northern Indian Ocean to have a clear tracking of the kind of change that is happening happening in the Indian Ocean with respect to climate change. And also we need to remember at this point, and the northern Indian Ocean is considered to be the most vulnerable ocean with respect to global warming and other associated issues, because Arabian Sea and Bay of Bengal, as you know, many of you know, they are actually considered as landlocked seas, cul-de-sacs, and it's only opening only towards the south. And the entire northern area is landlocked. So definitely the warming has a great impact on this area, having very less ventilation effect in the water column, because the renewal of the water is much, much slower in the northern Indian Ocean compared to any other ocean. So indications of climate change in plankton, there is a strong evidence of systematic change from the other part of the world, because such surveys were existing only in those areas. So if you see some of those evidences, Antarctic krill, which are a key component of the diet of whales and other marine mammals, have declined in abundance by more than an order of magnitude during the past 25 years. This decline has been linked to reduced food availability for krill in the form of phytoplankton blooms. And we can see another picture, another diagrammatic representation from a publication in Science. In fact, this is a result of a CPR survey. Many of you know the term regime shift, which is defined as rapid reorganizations of ecosystems from one relatively stable state to the other. And if you see in the North Sea, the situation is this. This is a 2003 to 2005 is the topmost panel. And the down, it is 1958 to 1981. You can see the kind of change that is happening on plankton or regime expansion you would see. 1958, mostly it was in the southern area. Sorry. It is getting continuously getting expanded towards north and north. And 2003, 2005, you can see the entire northern sea, the regime of this plankton getting expanded. And this is another evidence, abundance of Calanus copepods. In fact, you can see the two species of Calanus here from 1960 to 2000. And the blue one is Calanus himmarchicus, and the second one is Calanus helgolandicus. The Calanus himmarchicus abundance decreases. You can see very clearly it decreases from 1960 to 2000, but Calanus helgolandicus, it's proportionately, if you see, its percentage increases over the years. So that kind of you know, composition shift in plankton is can be quite expected in regions of climate change impacts. And since there was no CPR surveys, there is no point in blaming that nobody has initiated it. There could be a lot of so many genuine reasons for it. So 3-4 years before, we wanted to start initiate CPR. Even if long-term data sets are not available, we wanted to initiate it in Indian waters. And this is one of the images. It shows the first time when we tried the CPR in Indian waters from Bay of Bengal to Arabian Sea in one of our cruises on board Sindhu Sangal. So I would like to conclude this presentation here by stating this important sentence and sentences. Understanding how climate change affects the marine ecosystem is a key issue worldwide, for which plankton can be considered as early indicators. But our situation in Northern Indian Ocean is not so good, as I explained. So far, we do not have a long-term data set of plankton to make realistic and scientific comparisons to search for a change. The global warming and acidification are sufficient to reduce phytoplankton productivity and impact aquatic mammals, birds, and coral reefs. Oceanic pH should be ideally around 8.2. It is now under 8.1. And if it drops by further 0.1 to 0.2 units, we will have very visible implications, signatures in marine ecosystem, which could be more serious than climate change. Lower productivity and reduced carbon dioxide fixation and cloud cover, these factors can lead to carbon dioxide and temperature to rise and pH of the ocean to fall, some sort of feedback mechanisms. Any major change in plankton productivity and diversity pattern will have a negative impact on ocean biological cycles, certainly on marine fisheries. Plankton monitoring programs worldwide will act as sentinels to identify future changes in marine ecosystems. I urge for long-term plankton monitoring, because since climate change is a serious issue world over, it is a quite a very usual fashion that any change over a period of months or year, I could see in many publications people just blindly related to climate change. But we need to be very, very careful, scientific, and sensible to make such changes connected to climate change, because climate change is a very slow process. You need to have a very long-term data set to address it. In this context, even I appreciate some of the data on the fisheries is the regime expansion Dr. Vivekanandan sir has recruited, because at least they have a data set, long time data set of fish landing, which is one of the only data set I would say available, long time data sets with its all complexities, intricacies, limitation. That is only long time data sets on biological components in the ocean available. So at least it is, to certain extent, it is logical to go with it. But with respect to plankton, we have to be very, very careful, as we do not have long-term data sets available to have a clear assessment of the kind of change, climate change caused on the plankton and the ecosystem. That's all about this presentation. Thank you very much.